welcome to Caradise. So glad you're here. Don't do much to stand. Let's sing together. This is our prayer that we would draw closer to God. We trust that His Spirit will draw near to us in return.
Yeah. Thank you so much for worshiping with us this morning. Go ahead and have a seat, and we'll check out what God's doing in our community.
Our mission is to live and love like Jesus. One way we do this is by giving one extra dollar to help those in our community know and feel the love of Christ. We call this One for One. Last week, our offering went to a woman who has had a very tough time recently with her health. Shortly after completing surgery for an aneurysm, she caught COVID and had to be admitted to the hospital to help with her oxygen levels. Our dollars will go to help her with her financial burdens and show her that there is a God who wants her to heal and rest. Because of your generosity, here's what we were able to bless her with. This week's One for One was nominated by a member of Calvary Bellevue North for a woman who recently lost her husband very unexpectedly. She is now left to care for her two teenage children and deal with the bills that come with losing a loved one. Our dollars will go to help them financially, as well as give them some much needed peace of mind during this time. Thank you for giving to the One for One. When we give, we are working together to reach one life at a time.
See, I first became aware of these two churches in Red Oak when I was at Nebraska Christian College, and I had preached at the Nishna Church of Christ. Later on, I had preached a revival meeting at Hope for Life Church, but it was Troy Backus that let me know that there was a lot of room for opportunity where these two churches might do something together.
Through the work of our local church initiative, Jim started digging in with Hope for Life Church and Nishna Church of Christ in Red Oak, Iowa. As they worked together, it soon became clear that God was very much still at work, but there was a unique opportunity to do more together than apart.
The process of merging these two churches began out of a series of meetings that I had had with the Nishna Church of Christ, where Kelvin Jones, who was the preacher here at Nishna, invited me to come and do some strategy meetings with them. And the more we talked, the more we dreamed, the more we decided it would be helpful to have, you know, more than one church involved in revitalizing this area. It was pretty obvious that they were both about the same age range as far as membership. The philosophies of ministry were about the same, doctrine was about the same. And they were both in the same boat when it came to the situation where they had been bigger at one time, and now they were both down to about 10 to 15 people on a good Sunday. And it just seemed like the best option to pursue. And as we talked about it, they were both open to the idea.
Both churches were small, we didn't really have an option. We weren't growing. And what we were doing apparently wasn't working.
So with their congregation and with ours, we're averaging around 19 people now. Otherwise, we had 8. So we are in the process of growing, and there's more hope to be growing more. We're merging. We're a new family together now. We just learn about each other every day, and that's what's neat about it. We want our church to grow. We want the community to know that we're here, and we accept anyone that is willing to learn about God.
The idea, build it and they will come, hasn't proven to be that kind of a philosophy that works. You've got to go out and meet the people where they are, and there's a lot of unchurched people in Red Oak that we would like to think need a church home.
In merging two churches, we were really clueless on a lot of things that needed to happen, and that's where Calvary and Jim came in, because they had the expertise and the knowledge on how to do it. We did not. And it was time for us, what I would call, to let the professionals kind of take over and guide us. It's like a marriage. When you get married, you take on two personalities, And Jim and Calvary have been the glue to keep this marriage on track. So it's been invaluable.
It's nice to know that we have somebody who is backing us. It makes us feel a lot more successful in what we're trying to do. It's big when you're trying to renovate and pull two churches together and you're giving up something of your own, but you're hoping that it'll make it better. So we appreciate that.
Hey, isn't that awesome? Yeah, how many of you grew up in a smaller town? All right, you know, I did as well, and so it just does my heart so much good that we get to be a part of something together to make an impact together through our generosity to help revive churches like this and many others throughout the region so that more people can know Jesus in these communities. And so my name is Scott. I'm glad to be with you today. I want to welcome you, whether you're joining online or in person at one of our campuses. Truly glad to be with you. And one quick announcement before we get going. We do something around here. It's a partnership with a ministry called Financial Planning Ministry. And what this means is we as a church leadership invest in a partnership with this organization so that that organization can provide to anybody in our church family some long-term planning for your future. And what that means is this: approximately 80% of people do not have a plan in place for what would happen to them, their resources, even their family, should the unexpected happen. So no matter if you're in your 20s or in your 80s or anywhere in between, the partnership with Financial Planning Ministry helps people learn about things like living trust, will, estate planning, things like that. And it's something that we as a church provide free of charge for anybody to take advantage of. The seminar is coming up March 20th. You can go to our website there. You can see on the events page, find Financial Planning Ministry. You can go and you can hear all about it. And should that be something you want to do, the professionals of Financial Planning Ministry can meet with you one-on-one and you work out your plans with them. This would be something that would cost quite a bit of resource for you to do on your own. It's just something we want to provide as a ministry to our church so that you and your family can have that peace of mind knowing that you have things in place for anything that would happen. So Michael and I did this a few years ago. It's been a great peace of mind for us, and hopefully it will be for you as well. So hey, as we're getting started today, I want to start with a word, and that simple word is the word stop. Everybody say stop. Stop, all right? You know, when we're young, maybe that word first comes to our vocabulary when we get a sibling. And that sibling is bothering us, and we make sure that dad and mom know because we scream the word, stop, right? And it's usually like this blood-curdling, like, stop, you know? And those of you going through that phase of parenting right now, it does kind of get better. It just changes. All right, you know, so we say stop. Maybe it was at school, you had a guy or a girl who was bothering you, they were taking interest in you, and you just want them to leave you alone, and you would just say, would you please stop? Just please give me some space, right? Some of you, how many of you grew up in the 60s? I didn't want to guess, but some of us, right? Yeah, if you grew up in the 60s, there's a song by the Supremes with some relational advice. Are you with me? You gotta, in the name of love, stop in the name of love, right? Some of you are a little more sophisticated with your musical taste. You grew up in the late 80s, 90s, and you knew that there was a guy who came along and he called you VIPs. Yo, VIPs. And the lyrics go on to say, you gotta stop, collaborate, and listen. Ice is back with a brand new invention. So, will it ever stop, yo? I don't know. Literally had a conversation in the lobby with a girl who was 28. Her brother had invited her to church today, and she stopped. She said that message, and then we started talking. Her brother is older than her. And he's like, oh, yeah, I'm Vanilla Ice. She goes, what? I like, stop, collaborate, and listen. She's like, huh? She's 28. I'm like, your life has been robbed of the joy of Vanilla Ice speaking wisdom into you. Some of you don't know what I'm referring to, and that's fine. Hey, you know, we're not very good at stopping, are we? Because we are a culture and a generation that values go, 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 and being busy, busy, busy. We have places to go, things to do, people to see, things to be a part of. I don't know about you, but I mean, it takes a lot to get me to stop. And what I mean is this, I feel like I'm in a very busy season of life. I've always felt like I'm in a busy season of life, whether it was when I was 19 and single, or you know, mid-20s and married, or then marriage with one kid, and then marriage with two kids, and then marriage with three kids, and then kind of going through all the phases of life. I mean, I feel like life is constantly busy. We, Michael and I are in this season of life where, you know, we both have full-time work that we do. We have a son in college, and he's been in the middle of college basketball season. Then we have a daughter with her club volleyball season, and son in club basketball season. And then, you know, all the school schedules and school events and the house stuff and the cars. And we got this little furry pet around the house and family and friends and all these things that are just, it can just feel like go, go, go. I have to get up, and at the beginning of the week, how many of you are list makers? List makers? Right? Some of you are like, what's a list? Right? And that's fine. You know, I love to, like, at the beginning of the week, I'm like, all right, get clear. Usually on Sunday nights, I'm thinking about the week ahead. You know, I take time to once a month really try to think ahead, and then each week try to, like, act upon that, what needs to be done this week, and then you break it down by day, and each day and each morning I'll kind of revise the list and make sure I'm on track with the things I need to do. And I don't like to be interrupted. Anybody else? Like, you know, when we make our plans and we have things to do, sometimes those interruptions kind of are like, we don't know what to do with them because we got things to do. But have you ever wondered if failure to stop, failure to allow margin to stop, failure to give yourself permission to stop, robs you from seeing the people that God wants you to see, the moments that God wants you to be a part of? This has been a conviction of mine, a growing conviction of mine over the last several months. And as we were planning out this series of Mark, I took this passage because this passage of scripture speaks to me very loudly and clearly. If you're just joining us today, we are walking with Jesus to learn more about him through the Gospel of Mark. And in the Gospel of Mark, the first part we just talked about, you can't come into contact with Jesus without being changed by Jesus. And now we're in the middle section of Mark, and we're looking at the movement of Jesus. And specifically talking about the movement that Jesus came to create. Jesus didn't come to just like say, hey, look at me, look at me. He came to say, hey, look at God, look at his goodness, look at his grace, look at his mercy, look at his love. And he developed a movement of people around him who would continue to spread that love and grace to other people. And so in teaching this movement, Jesus often had these moments where he would stop. Now, I know a lot of you think you're busy. You think you're busy, but have you ever tried being savior of the world? All right, that's Jesus who I'm referring to. And Jesus, as busy as he was, as important of things as Jesus had to do, he always modeled what it looked like to stop. Stop and be fully present in people's lives. Stop and look into their needs. Stop and listen. Jesus always made time to stop and care for people and have compassion for people. So some context today. Last Sunday, I shared that Jesus, ultimately, he's on a journey to go into the southern part of Israel, to Jerusalem, and he was up in the northern part of Israel. He had took his disciples up there, several days' walk. He had taught them some important things, and he said, hey, crew, we're going to go down to Jerusalem, and there I'm going to be betrayed, mocked, spit upon, beaten, flogged, and crucified, and then I'm going to die. And 3 days later, I'm going to be raised to walk a new life. And they're all like, whoa, Jesus, you're going to build a kingdom, and you're going to go, and you're going to sit on the throne. You become king of Israel. You're going to overthrow the Roman government. You're going to make us into a national powerhouse. Jesus, that's what we want for you. They were vying to sit on his right and left and be powerful people. And Jesus is like, no. I'm building a different kind of kingdom. I didn't come to be served, but to serve. Jesus didn't come with his authority and resource to get even more authority and resource for himself. He says, I have come to empty myself, to serve, to put the needs of others in front of myself. So he told them this, and we looked at that passage last week. Now he's traveling from the northern part of Israel, and they're traveling down, and most of his ministry happened in the Sea of Galilee. Sorry, I'm seeing a map in my head, if you see what I'm doing here, right? And he did most of his ministry by the Sea of Galilee. The most common route that most would travel towards Jerusalem would take them through Jericho. Some of you remember there's an old Bible story about how Joshua fought the battle of Jericho. This is Jericho. And this is where we pick up the passage today. It's about 15 miles from Jerusalem. Jesus is getting closer to his destiny, not the destination of Jerusalem, but the destiny to lay down his life for our sin. And it says this in Mark 10, verse 46. Then they came to Jericho. As Jesus and his disciples, together with a large crowd, we paint the picture real quick. Many times in scripture, when you see Jesus, he was with his disciples, which was a small crowd, small group. Sometimes the words say that Jesus was with a crowd. There was a crowd of people, and the vernacular of the day would have meant that crowd can mean maybe hundreds of people. And then this says there were large crowds. You see that in scripture as well. And large crowds indicate literally thousands of people. Now, understand with me, they are traveling from Jerusalem to Jericho. There are thousands of people. Now, part of the understanding we need to have is this. There is a huge nationwide celebration in Jerusalem every year called Passover, where people would come from all over and they would flock to Jerusalem. And the Passover was a time where they remembered how the nation of Israel had escaped Egypt, how the Lord had passed over the Israelite families. He did not have the sons killed in those families because they had the blood of the lamb over their doorpost. So the blood of the lamb, because of the blood of the lamb, they were passed over and they were spared. That's obviously a precursor to what Jesus did. Blood of the lamb, we can be saved, etc. So every year, the people are flocking to Jerusalem. So Jesus and his entourage, right, are heading towards Jerusalem. So these large crowds are gathered. They're heading out of the city. It says this, look, as we continue in verse 46, as they were leaving the city, they were leaving Jericho, there was a blind man, Bartimaeus, son of Timaeus. He was sitting by the roadside begging. I don't know when the last time is you've sat with somebody who's blind. I have several times in my life. It's admittedly been a while since I've sat with someone who's blind, but I remember being overcome at how much I would take for granted. I remember being overcome at what it must be like to be blind. And here is this blind man begging. Culturally at the time, we need to understand this, that this blind person begging, there were no government assistance programs at the time. There were no job training programs or job development programs for the blind. Culturally, we need to understand that those who were blind or diseased or lame, paralyzed, etc., they were viewed upon by most in the culture as having done something wrong. So this massive crowd is traveling out of Jericho. There's this blind man saying, please, please. Like he's just begging for something, for anything. And he's crying out, like, please, anybody, help me. And it says this. When the blind man, verse 47, heard that it was Jesus of Nazareth, he began to shout. Jesus, son of David, shouted out loud with me. Will you read this? Have mercy on me. Say it one more time with a little conviction. Have mercy on me. Many rebuked him and told him to be quiet. Why? Because he was a nuisance. He was in the way. He had a troubled past. There was a similar passage in John chapter 9 where Jesus encountered a blind person and the people around him said, Jesus, who sinned, him or his parents? That was the culture. Here's a blind person. Well, he must have sinned and therefore is now blind because of it. Or his parents must have sinned. Maybe that's why he's born blind. And again, like, you've done something wrong. That's why you're stricken with this illness. And so Jesus, like, in this moment, right, Jesus is traveling. News about him has spread. People have heard about the miracle he's done, the things that he's taught of God and new ways. And people are like, whoa. And all of a sudden, this blind man who's begging, just wanting something to eat, wanting something to provide for just his most basic of needs, he's begging. He's crying out. This is, wait, if you close your eyes, like, I did this exercise the last couple of weeks, like, just what this must have been like. Jesus, son of David. Have mercy on me. Some of us understand what it's like to cry out for mercy. Maybe imagine, sorry for bringing back trauma moments here, but imagine it was these moments where you were in the worst physical pain you've ever been in. And it might have been then that you're crying out for Jesus to have mercy on you. It might be in the worst relational pain you've ever been in. It might be in the most emotional pain you've been in, where you've lost someone or news of someone. It's just, you're crying out, have mercy on me. That's the posture of this blind man. He's like, Jesus, have mercy on me. He knows this is his only moment. Bartimaeus, let's put a name on him. His name is Bartimaeus, the scripture says. And our boy Bart is crying out for mercy. This may be his only chance to ever be in contact with Jesus, to ever have the opportunity to cry out to Jesus with Jesus in that close of proximity. He's crying out. And everyone else is like, shut up, man. This is Jesus. You know, gonna be king? Leave him alone. He's got important places to be. He's got important things to do. And I love this. Verse 48 goes on to share his persistence, but he shouted all the more, Son of David, say it with me, have mercy on me. In other words, this man knows that Jesus is his only hope. Jesus is his only hope. He says, I don't care what anybody else thinks. I don't care what anybody else is gonna think of me sitting by the road. I don't care about any of y'all. I just know I want Jesus to have mercy on me. Verse 49 says, Jesus stopped. I mean, this is Jesus, the Son of God. There are thousands of people traveling with him. They're watching what he's doing. They're saying, let's go to Jerusalem. Let's see this all play out. This is going to be incredible. Jesus has places to go, things to do, people to see, right? But Jesus stopped for someone who has an extremely debilitating condition, especially in that culture. Jesus stopped for someone who was begging just for a bite of food. Jesus stopped for someone that was continually ignored. Jesus stopped for someone who needed care and compassion. Jesus stopped for one. Jesus stopped to reveal the heart of God for those who were crying out for the mercy of God. And suddenly the crowd grows quiet. Jesus stopped and called him. He literally said, call him. Jesus couldn't see. He's probably hearing the shouts above the crowd. The guy is on the ground, apparently, from what we're going to see next. So they called the blind man. Somebody says, cheer up, get on your feet. He's calling you. Throwing his cloak aside. Now, depending on what theologian you like to study or what you like to learn, was there anything under the cloak? Did he have two cloaks on? I don't know, if you're blind and you can't see everybody else, maybe you think they can't see, whatever. It's a crazy scene. This dude gets up, like he's calling you. I mean, just picture thousands of people around and Jesus is calling you. And is somebody guiding him? I don't know, is he having to feel his way? Like somehow he makes his way to Jesus, and Jesus asks this very, may be obvious question to the man, but I think Jesus asked it for the benefit of everybody else. He said, what do you want me to do for you? I think I know what my answer would be if I was blind. I think you may know what your answer may be. And the blind man said, Rabbi, say it with me, I want to see. And I just want to see. It's like just a basic, fundamental gift of, I literally want to see the world around me. I want to see the people around me. I want to see colors. I want to see trees. I want to see the sky. I want to see a face of the voices of the one who have been mocking me or ignoring me. I want to see the faces of those who have helped me. I just want to see. I don't know about you, but if you imagine this moment, the desperation of this moment, I just want to see. And who is Jesus? Jesus says in verse 52, go. Your faith has healed you. And immediately he received his sight. And he followed Jesus along the road. What an image of somebody willing to just follow Jesus along the road. That's what faith does. That's what faith does. That's the God of miracles that is proclaimed in the Bible is filled with moments like this, where Jesus does only what Jesus can do. Jesus provides this moment and everyone around is like, who is this guy? What kind of king is this going to be? This is so convicting to me. When I look at this story, I could have read this story to you in a minute, said amen, and said, let's go figure it out on our own. And maybe there's value into that. How many amens can I get? Yeah, you're like, this is a long sermon. Wrap it up, man. If you could have read it in a minute. So I'm trying to read it in a minute. I can read that story in a minute just like you can. But when I read and I reflect, God, what do you have for us? What do you have for me in this story? What do you have for our church family in this story? This would not have happened had Jesus been unwilling to stop. Jesus was never too busy to take moments for those who were in his path. He always took moments for the ones who were in need. He always took these divine appointments, these interruptions, if you will, as opportunities. And as he's creating a movement of followers who will also make this love and grace of God known to others, Jesus is teaching his disciples. And I think here's the simple lesson, that following Jesus requires that we stop for others. Would you say it out loud with me? Following Jesus requires that we stop for others. It's convicting to me because, again, I like to be in control of my schedule. I know how much I need to do. I know the level to which I want to be able to do that. There's a lot of factors in my life. And so when these interruptions, if you will, come along, when I read these stories, I'm reminded to pause. I'm reminded that, like, Jesus, the Son of God, stopped for one, and there were thousands around him. And he stopped. Our lives over the last few years, we probably understand the word interruption better than we did before. And if you're like me, we probably process the word interruption in a way that quite honestly, is selfish, right? So meaning our schedule is interrupted, our career interrupted, our family life interrupted, our school and sports schedules interrupted, go on and on and on, right? We process it all as interruptions, like if something's going to disrupt the schedule, it's affecting me, versus seeing it as an interruption, a pause, a stop, if you will, as being an opportunity from God, as a gift that's meant for someone else. That the interruption is for someone else. Over the last few months, I've been, I've talked to our staff a little bit about this, shared it in January at the church, like this idea of growth mindset. Like, what does that mean? To have this mindset of, I just don't want to be stagnant or still in what I know. Like, there's things I know, for example, like about finances. There's things I know about my family. There's things I know about the world around me. There's things I know about whatever. And when it comes to my relationship with Jesus, I don't want to be stagnant. I want to grow. So I began asking God months ago, God, how do you want me to grow in my relationship with you? And one of the things that God began to impress upon my heart is just, once again, the value of the person in front of me. I don't do this perfectly. Again, because I'm busy, my mind is chasing all the things. I'm not saying every moment I lock down perfectly by any means, but the thing that God began impressing upon my heart is to say a prayer before I start interacting with someone. And that simple prayer is, God, remind me that this is your child. God, remind me that this is your child. So when I wake up in the morning and maybe my wife, Michaeline, has some things she wants to talk about, and I'm like ready to get out the door and do the things, and like, God, this is your child. When my kids, you know, when I'm busy, like if I'm busy late at night, right, and my kids are like finally getting to their homework and their teens, and their homework is hard, they don't know how to figure it out, and they need help, you know, and I am like neck deep in Twitter. I'm like, I am busy, 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 busy. I'm busy, busy, busy. And they're like, Dad, can you help? I'm busy. Got things to do right now. Twitter, Twitter, Twitter. Anybody else? Insta. Yeah. All right. Facebook, whatever, like you're on. Like some of us who understand social media, like it's a time trap. It's a time suck, right? It's like, ugh. Like, and I can just, God help me to remind me. God help remind me that as a parent, my job is to show Josiah, who's now in college, and Reagan and Grant, who you are in this moment. Like in this moment, not to be pushed off to another moment, not to be pushed off, but in this moment, through my work, through my interactions in community, through the teams that are, you know, wherever we're at, in this moment, help me to be rooted in this moment to know that this interruption, what I think is interruption, worded it this way, every interruption can either get in our way or it can show the way of Jesus. Every interruption that we feel like we have, we can view as either getting in our way or as an opportunity to show the way of Jesus. God, help me to see each and every person as you've created them, as your hope, your plan, your desire for this person. Yes, the people on the other team who I don't like how they yell at my kid. However you girls do that, I don't know. Z? Daughter told me Z. There we go. Right? Some of you are like, man, he is so random. Try living in this every day. Every interaction, every moment, the best I can, be rooted in the moment. And what did Jesus teach? Jesus continually taught, as I thumb through his life, just in the Gospel of Mark alone, I continually see how Jesus stopped for the one. How Jesus stopped in moments like this. Do you remember the question he asked? He's like, hey, call the blind guy. The blind guy comes and he says, here's an obvious one. Hey, what can I do to help? What can I do to help? I think if most of us were pressed in how we actually live our life and what we want for our life, what we would prefer is everybody around us live their life in a way where they ask us what they can do for us. Can I get an amen? Amen. Yeah. Wouldn't it be great if you wake up every day and maybe it's your family and they, good morning. What can I do to help you today? Well, let me tell you. Right? And they don't expect the question in return. That'd be awesome. When, you know, and you go out in the community, or you go to work, or you go to school, and everyone's around like, hey, what can I do to help you? And you're like, well, here's what you can do. Here's what you can do. Some of you are like, get out of my way. That's what you can do. Some of you are like, no, I got a list. Here's some things that you can do for me. Like we would say, hey, this is what you can do to help. In a position of leadership, it's not uncommon for people to say, hey, because of the position, right? Because you're in that position, I'm going to ask, like, hey, what can I do to help you? I had three people this morning before 8 o'clock ask me what they could do to help me today. Right? And sometimes there's a response and sometimes, and that's kind of nice. That's kind of empowering. But you know what's what feels better to me? I don't need anything. Do you need anything? And that can be the foundation of an incredibly healthy relationship. Sometimes the answer will be yes. Many times the answer will be no. If you're a parent, man, it's tough. Kids, depending on what season of life you're in, all the way up to beyond adulthood, it can be tough as a parent to think about what your kids need and when they need it and why they need it and what's the best way to teach them and show them the way of Jesus. If you're a spouse and maybe marriage has not been all you've dreamed it could be, and maybe the pandemic even accelerated that and made it worse, and there's issues and there's challenges underneath the surface, perhaps, you know, the struggles. Is it possible that Jesus would unlock something for us if we actually learn to wake up and look each other in the eye and say, hey, what can I do to help you? What can I do to help you? Here's the thing, and mean it, and be willing to back it up. And be willing to follow through. Like that, what could that do to heal and restore marriages and relationships? What about in your workplace? Maybe work is struggling and your organization is struggling and the bottom line is struggling and everybody knows it and there's bickering and there's conversations and maybe it's the team you're on, whether it's work or school or on a literal ball team right now, if you're a younger person, like it's maybe there's struggle and maybe you're expecting everybody to serve you and meet your needs so that you can be the one. But what if Jesus in this moment is saying, hey, if you're gonna follow me, it means you need to stop for others and you need to ask them what they need and what you can do to help them. I continually am blown away when I think about just the moment Jesus has with Bartimaeus. I've read this story probably literally 50, 60 times over the last week or two. It's a minute long to read. There's the massive crowds. There's this healing moment at the end. And it's literally verse 49, Jesus stopped. The thing God's been putting on my heart time and again is who's the one I need to stop for today? So let me just ask you, who is the one God is asking you to stop for today and just be fully present? Yesterday, in the midst of schedules at this place called the Iowa West Fieldhouse. Some of you have been there more, a couple hundred times easily over the last, I don't know how many years for youth sports. And some of you are like, that's too much. You might be right. I'm not going to give that to you. I love it. I love my kids, right? So we're there. Our team wins. Let's just say the other coach maybe wasn't real kind to his players throughout the game. And I don't know what's going on, but I notice the team leaves. They all leave in huff and puff. Our kids are still huddled up and talking. And I notice one kid goes and he sits down. And like eighth grade kid, sobbing all alone, like sobbing. And I don't know if you remember, man, what it's like to be an eighth grade kid. You don't do that, right? Unless you are absolutely broken. Like you might go find a quiet place. Like this kid could not take another step. Like he just stopped and sat down the closest place he could and just was falling apart. His parents come over to him and I'm just watching. Like it was a little bit of a scene and people are like, what's going on over there? And I'm just in this moment. And my family thinks I'm weird. Not all the time, most of the time. And they probably have a good point. But I'm the guy, I'm like, I just make a beeline. And I go over and create a conversation. So, hey, I don't know what's going on, but I feel the need to encourage you in this moment. I had seen what had happened with the way that he was treated and valued as a human being because maybe he didn't box out right every time. Maybe he didn't make the right cut every time. And I spoke life just for a few moments unto him, and I said, hey, I've been a coach. I've been a player. And I just began to speak life into him. And then as I did that, his parents are kind of like, what? Like who? I go, let me just explain. This is going to be really weird. I know I'm weird. It disarms people. I said, I'm a pastor. But really what that means is I just love Jesus. And I feel like, man, God broke my heart for your son in this moment. And I just feel like I'm supposed to come over and say a prayer for you and let you know it's going to be all right. And you're going to be all right. And you're an incredible kid. And you're going to be an incredible kid. And you'll have a better coach someday. And it'll be great. So I spoke life and I prayed, and it led to this conversation afterwards about just this moment of like being present. And when I have these moments, when I say, and I'm not asking you all to go speak to strangers, teenagers. Okay? Some of you have the gift, some of y'all don't. All right? But I'm just saying, who's the one God puts in front of you? That scene I am 100% comfortable in anywhere, anytime, every day. Like that's my, as the youth say, that's my jam. Youth probably in their 30s now understand that. Like that's my thing. Like being in that environment, like those are my people, if you will. And I'm like, but who are the ones for you? Where are the ones for you? And who are the ones God is calling you to stop for? You know, when the miracles of Jesus, why are they in the Bible like this? And why do we have these stories? And one, the Bible, you know, everybody would say, like smart people would say things like, it's to reveal the nature of God, his absolute divinity of God in the flesh, and it's to reveal his ultimate power and authority. And yes, that's absolutely true. But I believe, maybe in more layman's terms for me, what the miracles of the Bible mean are this, is that you are never too far gone. You are never too far gone. And that Jesus, the God, the Son of God, the Jesus who came into this world, that he hears us when we shout out, Jesus, have mercy on me. Would you come into my life? And Jesus is like, stop. Everybody stop. I want heaven to stop right now. Call him. Call her. I think Jesus said, what do you need? What can I do to help you? And just as Bartimaeus knew, man, I want you to heal me so that I can see. Jesus knows, and he longs for us to cry out to him, and that's why he came. And that's why on this journey of the movement, we're seeing how Jesus went. He will soon be beaten, crucified. Why? To pay the penalty for your sin and for mine. And in understanding that he is the one who will stop for Bartimaeus, he is the one that will stop for you, he will stop for me. And these interruptions that we see in our life, they are not meant to get in the way. They are meant to ultimately show the way of Jesus. So church, let's continue to be a family who partners with him in these moments. Yes, on Sunday mornings, but all throughout the week, in our homes, in our community, and within our church family. Amen. God, help us to see you and to look for you, to be the people you have called us to be. And I thank you so much, God, that as we're following the life of Jesus, we are seeing him journey, God, from a place of ministering to others by showing your power and glory, God, to humbling himself and become a servant who would die on the cross for our sins. God, I thank you that Jesus stopped for Bartimaeus. I thank you that he's willing to stop for each of us. And God, may the prayer of our heart continually be, God, who are the ones you want us to stop for? God, who are the ones that need to see that you're their child today? God, and I thank you that in this moment, we all need to pause and stop and think about how we are that one who needs to see you today. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
So we're going to take that moment and pause or stop here for a moment and recognize that around the world, in the subways in Kiev, right, that we've been hearing about, online today with us and right here in our room and across the rooms all throughout our city, Christians are gathering to stop and remember, right? We take this communion weekly here at Calvary, frankly, because we need it, right? We need that regular reminder of what God has done on a big scale on our behalf. And so in just a moment, you'll take that piece of bread and it will remind you of the horrific way in which Jesus offered his body to be broken on our behalf. And we'll take the juice and we'll remember that he shed his blood that we might have life. But can I just encourage you this morning to pause long enough to maybe remember this? If God, through Jesus and his actions on the cross, was able to solve your greatest problem, which is sin, right? What makes you think he can't handle the thing that's been bugging you this week? The thing that you carried into the room with you today that feels too heavy or too big or, you know, it's just been going on so long. As you take this, remember what Jesus did, big scale. Makes us believe and trust like a blind man. He might be able to solve that problem too. Let's pray together. God, for the life and the hope and the amazing work of grace and mercy that the cross demonstrates in our life, for all of these things that are just a beautiful gift from you. We're going to stop and we're just going to remember just the nature of a God who loves us this much, that we might have life, that we might have relationship with you, and that whatever else comes after that, God, we know you're big enough for. And so we trust you in Jesus' name. Amen.
Please stand and worship with us.
Glory, near the rain.
to the one who breathes inside of us. Oh, praise Him. Oh, praise Him. To the one who died upon the cross. To the one who rose victorious.
Hello and good morning, everyone. For those of you who do not know me, my name is Matthias, and I serve as the middle school pastor here at Calvary. We have a full March here at Calvary, and so I wanted to just kind of give you guys a reminder. And so if you guys have calendar, if you guys want to pull those out, you guys can. On the 16th, so not this Wednesday, but next Wednesday, we're having a worship night here at Bellevue South, and it's going to start at 6:30 p.m., and this is going to provide a chance for all of us to kind of just put away the busyness and the craziness of life and just really come and just focus on just worshiping God for who He is. And so on March 20th, next is going to be an all-in meeting. If you've never attended one of these, I would highly recommend it. It really just shows like what God has done through Calvary all the way up until this point. And it also, we get to share with you guys where we are going as well. And so if you haven't attended that, or if you consider yourself to be all-in at Calvary, that is for you. Lastly, we have the Women's Retreat, which is going to be in March 25th and the 26th. And registration is still open for that. And so if you're willing or if you want to do that, you can sign up through our website, calvary.ch/events and whatnot. And so, yeah, other than that, if this is your first time here, we just want to say welcome and thank you so much for spending your morning with us today. If you wouldn't mind stopping by the Welcome Center, we would love to hand you a free t-shirt because that's just what we do. And without that, let's just go in. Live and love like Jesus today. Goodbye, everybody.